promoting a healthy environment. It's the air we breathe. Clean, safe water. Responsible management of our natural resources. We protect and restore for a sustainable future. Environment matters.
We wanted to have as little environmental impact as possible and be part of a sustainable food system, so it was very important to us to come up with a production method that spoke to all those things.
A 200-year-old family business with a 21st century attitude is reintroducing a unique West Virginia product to the world. Plus,
we've made tremendous progress in the last several months.
We'll visit a community garden project in one city that's bringing some relief to a neighborhood food desert. Hello, everybody, and welcome to another edition of Environment Matters. I'm Greg Adolfson.
And I'm Kelley Gillenwater. When you think of West Virginia's best-known mineral resource, you probably think of coal.
But that wasn't always the case. In fact, if you go back to the mid-1800s, West Virginia, and the Kanawha Valley in particular, was actually the largest salt-producing region of the United States. Hundreds of wells along the Kanawha River produced salt on an industrial scale, more than 3 million bushels each year.
Now, one local family is reviving that tradition in a much smaller and more environmentally friendly way. The DEP's Jake Glantz joins us now with more on their story.
Well, Kelly, Greg, the J.Q. Dickinson Salt Works in Malden produces sea salt, which seems like a pretty neat trick considering the lack of beachfront property in West Virginia. No, their salt comes from an ocean trapped far beneath our feet.
From the outside, it looks like a greenhouse, but what's growing inside isn't flowers or vegetables. It's crystals of salt. Inside these sun houses, salt brine fills these shallow trays where it slowly evaporates.
It's really a three-step process. So you've got the evaporation, and then once this brine reaches a certain salinity level, we then move it to a separate, another greenhouse. We spread the brine really thin out there, and then that's when you see the crystallization. So you got evaporation, crystallization, and then we process the salt.
From wellhead to finished product, the process takes about 5 weeks. It's a very hands-on process, and it can be pretty hot work too. Afternoon temperatures inside the sun houses can reach 150 degrees in the summer.
The salt will crystallize in these beds, and so usually in the mornings when it's cooler, we come out and we harvest all of the salt, we scrape it all together, and then we put it into these flower pots to drain because we want it to be as dry as we can get it when we bring it inside. We do more drying inside, but this way we keep as much of the brine and later the nigari in the same bed so that we can harvest that later as well and keep making more salt.
The well at J.Q. Dickinson's is about 350 feet deep. That's much shallower than the 1,000 to 1,500 foot deep wells drilled all along the river when the Kanawha Valley salt industry was at its peak. But it's deep enough to tap the mineral richness that lies below.
The source is actually from an ancient ocean. It's called the Iapetus Ocean. It's anywhere from 400 to 600 million years old. And I think the source varies depending on where you are in the eastern part of the United States, but you can find it as far north as Michigan. It probably comes down to Kentucky, Virginia, North Carolina. So it just so happens that it's bowling here, so it's a little more prevalent, and so it's a very rich source.
And it's that source that makes this salt so special.
I like to think of salts as like wines from around the world. They give you an expression of the earth from which they're grown. And our salt's flavor profile comes from the minerality in it. And while it's 95% sodium chloride, that 5% of trace minerals is different from here than it is from anywhere else in the world, any other source. So that's what makes our salt stand out.
Lewis and Nancy are the seventh generation of their family to operate the salt works here in Malden. The original Dickinson salt makers first drilled for brine on the property back in 1817.
There were several factors that were involved in our decision to start this business back and revive our family salt business. The major one is the movement of chefs and consumers toward very naturally made local products. And the demand for that is really growing as consumers want more and more naturally grown and produced products. Also, there are more consumers and chefs that have more than one salt in their pantry, and they're more educated about what those salts mean and the flavor varieties that you can get. Also, with our deep family heritage, we thought, okay, with that too, it was sort of an aha moment. We couldn't not start this business again, so we felt everything was, all the stars were aligned, and we were ready to move forward.
Using the sun and wind to make salt might not be the fastest way to do it, but these artisans aren't really concerned about speed.
Well, we're small batch. We're intensive on quality as opposed to quantity, but we do make quite a bit of salt. Our season is 8 to 9 months because we're not producing much salt in the winter, but last year we made about 6,000 pounds of salt. This year we hope to make at least 7. So, but we're selling it by the ounce, so that's a lot more than you think. So our supply's there and the demand's growing, so we feel pretty good about it.
And we wanted to have as little environmental impact as possible and be part of a sustainable food system, so it was very important to us to come up with a production method that spoke to all those things. And solar evaporation in greenhouses seemed to be the way to go. We're striving to be 100% no waste. Not only are we saving our iron as part of our settling process, we also have, after we harvest our salt, there's a liquid that's left, it's called nagari, and it's basically the minerals that don't adhere to the salt crystals. We harvest that and we sell that as well. It's traditionally used to make tofu, but it can also be used to make fresh cheese. It's a natural coagulant, so and you get all those minerals when you're using it for that. So. From start to finish, we're 100% no waste. We're very proud of that. And, you know, that's the way everyone should be moving, is to have as little environmental impact as possible. It's our responsibility as humans on the earth.
The folks at JQ Dickinson say they're even looking into solar panels to run their pumps and fans to make the entire operation powered by the sun. For Environment Matters, I'm Jake Glantz.
Thanks, Jake. You can find out more by visiting the website jqdsalt.com, which includes some very interesting recipes.
I have some of their salt in my kitchen. The flavor is really bright and intense. It's great on salted caramel.
Caramel, or caramel as I say it. Potato, potato.
The weather was a little less than cooperative for Huntington's first sustainability fair. The fair, which was held back on May 16th, featured workshops and demonstrations and live music and rain. Lots and lots of rain. Despite the soggy conditions, about 300 people turned out for the festivities at Heritage Station. A late afternoon severe thunderstorm forced organizers to cancel the evening's musical entertainment, but the good news is it's rescheduled. The Sustainability Music Fest will take place on June 27th at Heritage Station. About 80 different groups had presentations or booths at this year's fair, and organizers say they got a lot of positive feedback. The Sustainability Fair was organized by the Living Local Project, a volunteer-led effort to inspire residents to live a more locally based sustainable lifestyle, according to the group's website. West Virginia is getting $1.6 million in federal EPA grants to help assess and clean up abandoned former commercial and industrial sites, known as brownfields.
The cities of Huntington and Martinsburg each received $400,000 in grants to conduct site assessments at several locations with potential contamination issues from petroleum or other hazardous substances. The EPA selected the Business Development Corporation of the Northern Panhandle for 3 brownfields cleanup grants totaling $600,000, including here in Chester at the former TS&T Riverbank site. The company made pottery here from 1900 to 1982. The site is contaminated with metals. The grant also covers cleanups at the former Willing Corrugated Steel Manufacturing Plant, which closed in 2012, and Brook Glass, which has been vacant since 2005. Both of those sites are in Wellsburg. The EPA also awarded the DEP a $200,000 grant to prioritize brownfield sites, perform assessments, and prepare cleanup plans for sites located here in the Kanawha Valley.
Senate Bill 423, which passed during the 2015 West Virginia legislative session and went into effect June 12th, amended the above-ground storage tank and public water supply protection acts. Among the changes is an altered definition of what is considered an above-ground storage tank, and so tank owners who previously registered their tanks may need to remove some of them from the program. If tank owners don't deregister tanks that no longer fit the statutory definition by July 1st, those owners will be sent registration invoices of $40 per tank. For more details, including how to determine if a tank is covered under the new regulation and, if not, how to deregister that tank, visit our website, dep.wv.gov. Summer is finally here, and before too long, gardeners will begin harvesting the first of their homegrown vegetables.
But some folks, people who live in apartments or in tight urban lots, for example, don't always have the space to plant. That's where community gardens come in. The DEP's Brianna Hickman takes us to one project in Fairmont that's kicking off its second season.
This former tennis court is now an oasis in the middle of a food desert.
Well, it's a wonderful benefit to have the garden here. There is not a grocery store within walking distance of this neighborhood. And so to be able to have an opportunity for residents to plant fruits and vegetables and harvest them on their own is really a tremendous opportunity for our community.
This is the second season for the Fairmont Community Garden Project, a collaborative effort between the city, the neighborhood, and Fairmont State University.
We've made tremendous progress in the last several months. We've completed our rainwater collection system. We have filled the remaining garden beds, and we've really planted a lot of plants so far this season.
The rainwater collection system was a hands-on learning project for the university's engineering department.
The goal was to see the big picture of the system, understand the processes, be able to create a relationship within engineering to project management, and looking at deadlines and constraints and timelines and being able to work with the project hopefully has brought a lot more to the table of the reality of what engineers really do. They were able to achieve and accomplish this project through the semester period of time, which added levels of stress within other projects that they were currently working on. We were also able to take this project right to the classroom.
When we built this, we made it so that we could use the same roof over top of it to limit the space in here, because that way in the future we can build more garden beds, so the water will come in, goes in through a 3-inch pipe, it'll fill up the first tank on the left. Once it fills up, it'll overflow into the second tank, and everything's sealed. So once the second tank fills up, there's an overflow on the far right that goes out the back for the extra rainwater. And we build a manifold in the front to where we can use either tank. Once this one's full, it'll go over, fill this one up. And then we can save this water, since this is the second one to fill up, we can save it and then use this one. That way, if we have a long time period without rain, we can go just off of that one there. The manifold goes into four valves. There's two on either side here. You got two on the front, two on the back, that we can run a hose out of each side. We have a hose reel that we can hook this to, and when we get more water in there, the pressure will be a little higher, where students can actually, or community can actually, go through and garden instead of having to carry the cans up.
Other improvements from last year: this bridge that crosses Cole Run and connects the community garden to the 5th Street Park, located just up the hill.
The reaction's been wonderful. We have had such tremendous support from the university and the city. We've had student groups here. We've had businesses come and visit. So it's really been wonderful to see the community support for this project.
And project organizers say they hope that support continues to grow, just like these tomatoes and peppers. In Fairmont, I'm Brianna Hickman for Environment Matters.
The project was financed in part by a $25,000 grant from the Ford Motor Company. Fairmont State's C3 grant was just one of only 10 winning student sustainability projects nationally, and the only one in West Virginia. In addition to providing neighbors a place to grow healthy food, the community garden also provides fresh fruits and vegetables to the Nest Student Food Bank on campus.
Just ahead, we'll meet the folks behind the 2015 West Virginia Watershed of the Year.
I feel like in this particular community, because we live right next to the river, we're especially aware of the river and changes and aware of the watershed.
Plus, we're cleared for takeoff. seeing the world from a slightly higher perspective. Those stories and more when Environment Matters continues.